Hello, my name is Clay Thompson. I'm a developer in statistics R&D at SAS. In this presentation, I'll provide an overview of some recently developed SAS procedures that provide tools for causal analysis. These tools cover causal effect estimation, causal mediation analysis, and causal graph theory for establishing valid estimation strategies. First, let me say a few words about the importance of causal analysis and the features that distinguish a causal analysis from more familiar predictive tasks. Causal questions are ubiquitous in applied research. For example, in medicine, you might want to investigate the effect of a behavior or exposure, such as smoking, on some measure of health, such as blood pressure. Similar questions arise in social and public policy, behavioral science, epidemiology, environmental science, and many other fields. In all these cases, there is a treatment or exposure, T, and an outcome of interest, Y. The goal of a causal analysis is to quantify the causal link between T and Y. Note that this causal link represents a stronger claim than a purely predictive association between a pair of variables. In other words, the goal is to understand what would happen to the outcome variable if you were to intervene and change the treatment variable, for example, by applying or removing the treatment. It's important to note that causal analysis is not limited to settings in which it is possible to conduct a randomized controlled experiment. Rather, it is often the case that you seek to answer a causal question by using observational data, such as electronic health records, cross-sectional surveys, and so on. In these settings, you must often make statistical adjustments to account for confounding factors and the biased selection of patients into treatment. SAS has several procedures to help you make these adjustments. There are four procedures in SAS-STAT software that are designed specifically for causal inference. This table provides a summary of these four procedures. They contain many features that will help you quickly and rigorously answer your causal research question. As a reminder, all these procedures, including some feature enhancements, are available in SAS Viya. Now I will demonstrate the use of all four procedures through examples. Consider the following healthcare application. You have a data set collected from electronic health records for patients undergoing coronary artery bypass graft or CABG surgery. Following surgery, these patients receive physical therapy either on-site at the hospital where they had the surgery or off-site from alternative providers. Your goal is to determine whether on-site physical therapy improves patient outcomes. Here you see the first 10 records in the data set. The binary variable, PT-LOC, is an indicator of whether a patient attends physical therapy off-premises. This is the treatment variable. The continuous variable, post-EFRAC, is the change in ejection fraction of the heart before and 3 months after surgery. This is the outcome variable. The data set also includes the baseline covariates, age, the age of the patient in years, GM-INT, an indicator of whether the patient expressed interest in attending post-surgical support meetings at the hospital, pre-EFRAC, the ejection fraction of the heart before surgery, and surgery, an indicator of whether the patient received traditional CABG or off-pump CABG. Note that these data were not produced as part of a randomized controlled trial. In other words, they are observational data. Here is the specific research question. For patients who attended physical therapy off-premises, how would their outcome be different if they had attended physical therapy on-premises? There are two things to notice about this question. First, we are interested in the causal effect in a particular subgroup, patients who choose physical therapy off-premises. Second, the research question involves a counterfactual quantity. What would have happened to these patients if they had made a different choice? You can think of a causal analysis as a framework that combines the data you have with assumptions about the data generating process to address such counterfactual queries. Now that you have seen the data and the procedures that are available to analyze those data, how do you put these pieces together to perform a causal analysis? This diagram summarizes various research activities related to causal analysis and the procedures you would use for each activity. The first steps are to clearly state your research question and identify the causal quantity of interest. To do so, you need to think carefully about the underlying data-generating process. Here, PROC causal graph can be useful. Causal graph does not estimate a causal effect itself. Rather, it takes your assumptions about the data-generating process and turns them into valid statistical strategies you can use to estimate a causal effect. To estimate a causal effect, you can use the PS match, causal treat, or causal med procedure. Your choice of procedure depends on the causal quantity of interest and your preferred estimation method. Let's start with PROC causal graph. As a reminder, your goal is to assess the effect of on-site versus off-site physical therapy for patients who undergo CABG surgery. The simulated data mimic an observational study in which patients can make their own choices about their physical therapy location. Many immediate or direct factors contribute to this choice, including health status prior to surgery, the surgery type, and the distance from the patient's home to the hospital. There are also remote or indirect factors, such as the patient's receptiveness to medical care, that affect the choice of treatment. You can summarize the causal relationships among these variables by using a directed acyclic graph, or DAG. A DAG is a type of graphical causal model in which direct causal relationships are represented by directed arrows between variables. These causal relationships reflect your assumptions about the data-generating process. Note that the graph is purely qualitative. You do not need to specify the exact functional forms to describe the relationships among the variables. Thus, you can interpret a DAG as a non-parametric structural equation model. Note also that not all variables that appear in the graph need to be included in the available data. For example, a patient's receptiveness to medical care and measure of a patient's family or community support are latent constructs that are difficult or impossible to measure. Other variables, such as the distance from the patient's home to the hospital, could be measured but are not included in the available data set. There are two advantages to using a graph to represent the data generating process. First, the graph provides a transparent method of sharing your causal assumptions about the data generating process. Second, the structure of the graph determines which variables you should include for adjustment when you estimate the causal effect. This is the purpose of PROC causal graph. You use PROC causal graph to assess the identifiability of the causal effect that you want to estimate. To do this assessment, you use the model statement to specify all the edges in the directed acyclic graph that represents your data generating process. You can use an unmeasured statement to specify the variables that are latent constructs or are unmeasured in the observational study. For obvious reasons, these variables cannot be included in a statistical analysis. You use the identify statement to specify the treatment variable and outcome variables for your analysis. The PROC causal graph output provides a list of statistical strategies you can use to estimate the causal effect. Such an estimate has a valid causal interpretation if your graph is an accurate representation of the data generating process. In this example, there is only one valid adjustment set. This adjustment set contains the variables age, pre-EFRAC, and surgery. In other words, you need to include these three variables for statistical adjustment in your estimation strategy. This will be clearer in just a moment when I use PROC PS match and PROC causal treat to estimate the causal effect. Before I move on to estimating the causal effect, I should mention that in many practical situations, the construction of a causal diagram is a daunting or even insurmountable task. Additionally, not all researchers are keen on causal graph analysis. A sufficient alternative assumption is that you can specify all the relevant confounders in a situation under study, and that you can make statistical adjustments for these confounders. With such an assumption, you can go straight to effect estimation. Now, let's use PROC PS match to estimate the causal effect. Recall that for observational data, non-random sampling might introduce confounding bias because individuals self-select the treatment or control condition. Propensity score modeling is a way to account for this bias selection of treatment. It leads to adjustment methods such as propensity score matching, weighting, and stratification. The development of a propensity score model is an iterative process in which you repeatedly develop a propensity score model and assess the quality of the covariate balance that the model produces. You proceed to the outcome analysis only after you achieve a model of sufficient quality, as indicated by various diagnostic tools. In the interest of time, I will skip the iterative process, but you should be aware that PropPSMatch provides a large collection of covariate balance diagnostics to help you with this process. Here's the syntax for PropPSMatch. I will not explain all the options in detail, but I do want to mention a few important features. The PS model statement is where you set up your propensity score model. Recall from the prop causal graph analysis that there are three variables that must be included for statistical adjustment. You specify these three variables, age, surgery, and pre-EFRAC, in the PS model statement. You use the match statement to specify that you are using propensity score matching. With these options, PropPSMatch uses logistic regression to fit a propensity score model and estimate the propensity scores. Then for each observation in the treated group, it finds in the control group an observation that has a similar propensity score. You use the assess statement to request tables and graphics that you can use to assess the quality of the matching analysis. You will see an example of such a matching diagnostic on the next slide. PropPSMatch does not perform the outcome analysis. Rather, the matching information and the original data are saved in a new data set that you specify in the output statement. This data set contains weighting information that you would use to estimate causal effects. For example, you can use PropTTest to compute the average difference in the outcome variable between the treated and control groups. To do this, you specify the treatment variable PTLOC in the class statement. You specify the outcome variable in the var statement, and you use the weight statement to specify the variable containing the weights that PropPSMatch computed. As noted earlier, propensity score modeling is an iterative process, and it's important that you assess the quality of the model. PropPSMatch provides a wide range of diagnostic tools that you can use for this task. The standardized mean differences plot, shown here, is one such tool. This plot helps you visualize the differences between the treated and control groups in the original data, as well as after weighting and matching. For a high-quality matching analysis, the standardized mean difference should be close to zero after weighting and matching. An acceptance region with a width of 0.5 is shaded to aid interpretation. The blue X's represent the difference between the treated and control groups prior to weighting and matching. Notice the large differences for the variable age, as well as for the logit of the propensity score. This indicates an imbalance in the raw data that needs to be corrected for by the matching analysis. After weighting and matching, the standardized mean differences are represented by green plus signs. The weighted match differences for age and the logit of the propensity score are much closer to zero and well within the acceptance region. This is a good indication that the propensity score model, together with the matching analysis, is performing as desired and is correcting for the imbalance in the data. Again, PropPSMatch does not directly compute an outcome analysis. Here, I'm showing the same PropTTest code that you saw on a previous slide. The average weighted difference in the outcome variable is 0.5 units. Under the causal assumptions encoded in the graphical model, this difference has a causal interpretation. In other words, for patients who attended physical therapy off-premises, their change in ejection fraction of the heart would have been 0.5 units higher on average if they had attended physical therapy at the hospital. You can perform a similar analysis with PropCausalTreat. Here is a code sample that uses PropCausalTreat to compute the average treatment effect. Again, I will not explain the syntax in detail, but I do want to point out a few important features. CausalTreat supports propensity score methods, regression adjustment methods, and doubly robust methods to estimate a treatment effect. The code you see here uses a propensity score-based method, inverse probability weighting with ratio adjustment. The treatment variable and the covariates to be included in the propensity score model are specified in the PS model statement. Note that the three covariates, age, surgery, and pre-EFRAC, are the same three covariates from the prop causal graph analysis. The outcome variable is specified in the model statement, For regression adjustment and doubly robust methods, you can use the model statement to specify an outcome model. The effect estimate that is computed by causal treat is negative 0.32 units, slightly different from the estimate computed by PROC-PS match. But which estimate is more reliable? The answer depends on the quality of the underlying analyses. Like PS match, causal treat can produce many diagnostic tables and graphics. In real-world settings, you should carefully review these diagnostics to assess the reliability of the results. Finally, let's look at PROC-CausalMed. As we have seen so far, a mediation analysis examines the causal link between a treatment variable and an outcome variable. The unique feature of a mediation analysis is the inclusion of a third variable, a mediator, that explains a portion of the total causal effect. For example, suppose you want to analyze the effect of an after-school program on decreasing the frequency of delinquent behaviors in a population. You might want to know how much of the effect of the program is attributable to changes in the moral and social values of the participants, as measured by psychometric assessment. The purpose of a causal mediation analysis is to explain and quantify a causal mechanism. It can answer questions such as, how important is a particular causal mechanism? That is, how much of the total causal effect can be attributed to a specific path? What would be the effect of a hypothetical intervention that acts directly on the mediating variable? Can such an intervention increase or decrease the effect of the treatment? Just as we discussed before, mediation analysis takes place in a setting with observational data, so it is important to account for confounding factors in the data generating process. Examples of confounding factors in the current example include the socioeconomic backgrounds of the participants and the baseline frequency of delinquent behaviors. Here is an example of the use of PROC-CausalMed. This example uses a simulated dataset called Youth. In the model statement, you specify the delinquent behavior as the outcome. The outcome model includes the effects of the treatment, the mediator, and their interaction. In the mediator statement, you specify the mediator variable value and the treatment variable program. In the COVAR statement, you list all relevant confounding covariates. Note that these confounding covariates are implicitly included in the regression models of the mediator and the outcome. Here is the output from PROC-CausalMed. The total effect is negative 0.56 units on the risk difference scale. That is, all other things being equal, participation in the after-school program causes a reduction of 0.56 units in the frequency of delinquent behavior. This total effect is decomposed into a natural direct and natural indirect effect. The percentage mediated is the ratio of these two quantities expressed as a percentage. In other words, approximately 20% of the total program effect is attributable to levels of the moral and social values of the participants. This concludes the overview of causal analysis procedures in SAS-STAT software. I hope you have found this introduction useful. A causal analysis is a three-part process in which you define the effect of interest, identify that effect from the available data, and then estimate the effect. This process requires that you clearly articulate your research question and carefully reason about the data generating process. The causal graph, PS match, causal treat, and causal med procedures are designed to fit within this workflow and provide powerful analytic tools to facilitate your causal analysis. For your reference, here is a collection of papers from previous SAS Global Forums. These papers provide overviews of the procedures featured in this presentation. Here are two additional SAS Global Forum papers. These papers offer a more detailed look at the causal procedures in practical workflows. Thank you for watching.